Thank you so much, Norman, for having me here. So I've been asked to provide the legal analysis for this topic, which is whether or not U.S. airstrikes violate international law based in Syria. So this is a really broad question, and I'm going to take a little bit of time to drill down into some more specifics and the international legal frameworks that apply in order to be able to answer this. So as I'm sure most of you are well aware, the UN Charter is the definitive legal framework that applies here. This is binding international law on the United States as a signatory. And Article 2.4 states that countries or states have an obligation to refrain from the threat or use of force against a territory or the political independence of any state. It seems like a pretty definitive prohibition, but there is, of course, an exception in Article 51, which states that states have a right of individual or collective self-defense. But if any state does use this exception, that any actions must then be immediately reported to the Security Council. So I'll look at two instances in the last few months to see how these legal principles apply. So, of course, April 6th, the attack on the chemical weapons, which occurred a few months ago. Now, the vast majority of legal experts all agree that the attack on April 6th violated the UN Charter and/or was unconstitutional for several reasons. One, there was no Security Council resolution authorizing the attack. The U.S. did not justify its actions based on self-defense. There was a statement released afterwards saying that this was done basically for humanitarian purposes based on how heinous the crimes committed by the Syrian regime were, these chemical attacks on civilians. And then in addition, of course, there was no authorization from Congress to use force in this circumstance. However, I think going against the majority of legal opinions that came out after this attack, former State Department legal advisor Harold Coe argued quite narrowly for a narrow affirmative defense for circumstances such as this based on necessity for humanitarian intervention. And he listed several criteria that would need to apply for this exception to take place, which I'm happy to refer you to if any of you would like that argument in more detail. But he did think that because of the circumstances in this case, that there should be a narrow exception in this case. So then, of course, as Norman mentioned earlier, the June 18th instance where a Syrian warplane was shot down by U.S. forces. Now here, the U.S. and Russia actually disagree about the facts and the law in this circumstance. So the U.S. claims that it acted in collective self-defense of coalition forces because the Syrian plane was bombing the Syrian Democratic Forces, which is one of the anti-Syrian rebel groups based in Syria. Now, Russia, however, says that the plane was providing air cover for Syrian ground forces who were fighting ISIS. So the U.S. action here violated Syria's sovereignty and international law and thus constituted military aggression against the Syrian government. So as I mentioned a few minutes ago, Article 51 does allow for collective self-defense of states, but not necessarily non-state armed groups like the SDF, or the Syrian Defense Forces. And just to be clear, the U.S. has not claimed that the SDF is a de facto organ of the United States. The U.S. is providing some support to the SDF, but it's not claiming that it's a de facto organ of the U.S. under its direction and control. Now, my colleague Adil Haq has suggested a novel legal approach here, which says that the U.S. could use necessary and proportionate force to defend member states of the coalition and coalition non-state armed groups against ISIS if defeating ISIS was its sole mission. And that's a very narrow exception here. And of course, in the law, there's no right to collective self-defense of non-state armed groups for regime change or other political goals. Now, what makes it complicated here is that Secretary Tillerson and Ambassador Haley, on a couple of occasions, have indicated that the Syrian regime change remains a U.S. strategic objective. So here, the fact that there could be some mixed motives for both fighting ISIS, which is a strategic objective of the United States, and possible regime change, the mixing of these motives compromise the legal basis for military operations that have occurred and may occur here in the future. So I'll look forward to your questions. Thank you.